flagoftawheed.com.
My lecture is entitled The Da'wah of All the Prophets, organized by Islamic Da'wah Center and Flag of Tawheed, which is to be part of the Ark of Noah, the second annual conference. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه. All praise is due to Allah. We praise Him, we seek His forgiveness, and we ask His assistance. ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. And we seek refuge with Allah from our evil souls and the consequences of our bad deeds. من يهده الله فلا مضل له. Whosoever Allah guides, no one can lead astray. وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ. And whosoever He allows to go astray because they do not want any guidance, then no one can guide. وَأَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. And I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship except Allah alone with no partners. وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and his messenger. أما بعد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. As to what follows, Allah says in the Quran, interpretation of the meaning in English, O you who have believed, have taqwa of Allah, the way He deserves it, and do not die except in the state of Islam. Allah goes on to say in another ayah, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ اِتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا. O you who have believed, O mankind, have taqwa of Allah, who created you from a single soul, and from that soul created its partner, that means Adam and Eve. And from them He dispersed many men and women upon earth. And fear Allah, to whom you demand your mutual rights, and reverence the wombs that bore you. Keep your kinship ties. Verily Allah ever watches over you. Then Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. O you who have believed, have taqwa of Allah, and say a good word. He will help you establish good deeds, and He will forgive you your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has attained the greatest success. أَمَّا بَعْدْ فَإِنَّ أَصْدَقَ الْحَدِيثِ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ. As to what follows, verily the most truthful speech is the Quran, the book of Allah. وَخَيْرُ الْهَدِي هَدْيُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. And the best of guidance is that of our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَشَرَّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتُهَا. And the worst of affairs are those that we introduce into this religion of ours. وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ. And every newly introduced matter is an innovation. وَكُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. And every innovation will lead astray. وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارٍ. And whatever is astray will be going to the hellfire. All praise due to Allah for giving us the opportunity to deal with a very fundamental topic this particular evening. The da'wah of all the prophets. Before we touch upon the subject in particular, there are some basics that we must cover first. And that is, why were we created? As you listen to me in this very moment, and as I speak in this very moment, what is the objective of my speech? And what is the purpose behind us gathering, whether in a physical sense or otherwise, to go over certain topics? Is it simply for practice? Is it academics? Or what is it? Obviously, we all agree, if we are Muslims, that there's an objective of life. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created us for a great purpose. And that great purpose was clarified in the Quran in ways that cannot be refuted. Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created jinn and ins except to worship. Yes, indeed. This is the objective of life. And everything that we do in this life should be means that will help us attain and fulfill that worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one way or another. For those who are mindful of Allah, it is done in a number of ways. As the ulama say, عادات أهل التقوى عبادات. The habits of the people of taqwa are in fact acts of worship, because they initiate that act of worship or that habit as an act of worship. They do it seeking Allah's pleasure. So eating, drinking, sleeping, and things of this nature, which is usually, you know, from the habits of the people that they must do, in the case of the one who is mindful of Allah, then this becomes in fact an act of worship. If this is the case, and if we were created for this purpose, to worship Allah, and if we do worship Allah, then we have been promised paradise and protection from the fire. If we fail to fulfill that purpose of life, then we will land in the hellfire, and we will not be permitted to paradise. So each one of us is making choices every single second of his or her life. How are we going to handle this moment? Are we going to handle it like those who are mindful of Allah and consequently be rewarded by Allah and eventually be placed in the paradise? Or are we going to act in a different way, and then we will have none to blame but ourselves on the Day of Judgment? It's a very crucial matter, and we are exposed to it on daily basis. We need to be mindful of these realities so we may act accordingly. We must understand the objective of life before we convey the objective of life. And this was the fundamental principle that the prophets based their da'wah on. The prophets were the most careless of the dunya. They were the most uninterested people in the dunya. Because of that, their main focus and interest was directed to the life to come. And as a result of that, they called the people to that same attitude and mentality. If you were to read the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it will become evident and clear that they were individuals who were striving to please Allah, who were striving to enter Jannah. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was quoted to have said in the Quran in Surah Al-Shu'ara, begging Allah Azza wa Jal, وَجْعَلْنِي مِنْ وَرَثَةِ جَنَّةِ النَّعِيمِ, and make me among the inheritors of the paradise of delight and pleasures. Ibrahim al-Khalil, the close friend of Allah Azza wa Jal, Ibrahim the Ummah, whom Allah called, he was a nation by himself. This great prophet from the prophets was begging Allah Azza wa Jal to allow him to enter Jannah. Meaning he was not concerned about the dunya. He did not ask Allah to increase his wealth. He did not ask Allah to better his affairs. Not that it is not permissible. However, this was not what preoccupied him. His preoccupation was the life to come, was entering Jannah. He said in the verses before that, وَالَّذِي أَطْمَعُ أَن يَغْفِرَ لِي خَطِيئَةِ يَوْمَ الدِّينِ, and it is he who I hope will forgive my sin on the Day of Judgment. This was the attitude, this was the motivation of the prophets and the messengers. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was no different. And we all know the narration where he alayhi salatu wasalam used to pray at night so long until his feet would swell. And then they would say to him, O Messenger of Allah, Allah has forgiven your previous sins and your future ones. Why, take it easy, you know, take it easy on yourself. He said, shall I not be a grateful servant to Allah? Shall I not? He wanted to compete with Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, because Allah praised Nuh, said, إِنَّهُ كَانَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. He was a thankful servant. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam wanted to compete with the prophets. He wanted to be the best among them and the closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the best in the sight of Allah. And indeed, he was alayhi salatu wasalam. It was after he had understood this reality, he gave da'wah. And this is fundamental in the da'wah aspect. Very often, brothers and sisters in Islam, we get excited and we try to engage in da'wah, even though ourselves, we ourselves... FlagOfTawheed.com